It might be possible that your progress can be greater than anything you can quite express, because you feel that in the expression of it, you're going to lose a lot of the essence of it. So that's fine. So what you do is take refuge in practice. Take refuge in practice. Where do we take refuge from this preparation for time to start? We take refuge in practice. And this is the important message we have here. This is a message that's continuously being emphasized. Take refuge in practice. Take refuge in practice. We have some very powerful, effective practices here, and we can't always take refuge in talking, because if you try to express to others in an explanatory way what you're experiencing has been. It can either be overwhelm them, it can be too much for them, you can lose a lot in the translation, and then you feel like I'm sort of uncertain. Well, so when you make a lot of progress, oftentimes it's full stop in the wow mode. You feel full stop in the wow, and sometimes you can take refuge in just practicing and just say, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, the progress that we're making now is off the charts. I woke up very early in the morning, and basically all morning have been having intense progress, astonishing. So I don't want to try and condense it down into some sort of explanation, because it was just so profound, so profound. So I kept reminding myself, go back into practicing. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And we have the already practiced. Yes, I already know that I already am absolutely free of all preparation for time to start. Yes, I already know that I am already experiencing the dream of preparing me for time to never start. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing the benefits of the dream of preparing me for time to never start. I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is my go-to practice, and I highly advise it. And I use it this morning a lot, and it keeps, what happens, it centers you, it centers you, it keeps centering you, it keeps centering you. So you need to keep, the progress we need to make now is so tremendous that we need to have a centering, be able to center ourselves. Otherwise, the wow is going to almost overwhelm us, really. And when you make tremendous progress, you want to share it with others. But remember, you're still in the shock of the wow. Okay, so if you try to share when you're still in the shock of the wow, then the wheels are going to start coming off. Or maybe later when the shock of the wow has worn off, then you can easily say what you want to say. But when you're in, you have to recognize when you have had some tremendous breakthroughs, you're going to have this backlash of this wow backlash. It's just wow, this is just, I don't even know how to measure what's going to happen. I don't know what's going to happen next. I don't know. So don't try and explain with words the situation and try to stabilize yourself that way. Stabilize yourself by taking refuge in practice. And we can do this practice of praising and condemning yourself and having equal reaction to all. Yes, I'm a great person. Or, hey, you're really a great person. Yes, I really am a great person. Hey, you're really a terrible person. Yes, I really am a terrible person. Hey, you're really stupid. Yes, I am really stupid. Hey, you're absolutely brilliant. Yes, I am absolutely brilliant. And by doing this type of practice, you really humble and center yourself. Okay. It takes all the air out of concepts and words and symbols. So taking refuge in practice is what will enable us to ultimately succeed. And success really is to liberate this, our dream universe, liberate it from the purpose that the original purpose we gave it, which was to prepare us for time to start, prepare us to dwell in the kingdom of time. Liberate it from that purpose and give it a new purpose, which is to prepare us to realize that time is never going to start. Which means prepare us to return to the kingdom of reality. It's not really a return, but it might seem that way as far as, you know, preparation goes. It really helps ease us out of the need for any dream or preparation at all. So prepare us to drop all preparation for time. Prepare us to be ready for the realization that time will never start, and thus we don't need to do any preparation for time to start, none whatsoever. This is the ultimate goal. Now, in this intense progress I made today, I realized that all these videos I've been making have been right on the mark, and they're going in the right direction, very, very much so. But to push further, I think everyone's already having enough trouble as it is. You know, it's like, oh my gosh, you know, this is, can this really work? And there are some very clever defenses that we have. And I saw through those defenses this morning. But it's such a wow experience that I just am just allowing that to sink in. Now, sometimes it's just really good to hang out in a situation where there's been tremendous clarity and breakthrough. Just to hang out. You don't necessarily even have to discuss what the breakthrough's about. So that's why I'm doing this video. The fact that I survived it, the fact that I'm okay, you know, is tremendous. It's absolutely tremendous. I was able to take a stand against delusion, that stronger than ever, and you know, this just sent shockwaves through the psyche, not of the mind. Not just my mind, but just of the mind. There's just one mind. Sent shockwaves through the mind. So I don't know how that's all going to echo and play out. I was studying some ancient history yesterday, and it's amazing how transparent it becomes when you read these ancient accounts. So they were very transparent in the way they talk and the way they describe things and the stuff happening. It was very raw and transparent. And of course, we've become much more sophisticated at camouflaging everything now. But reading the ancient histories and the way things happen, you get a much clearer picture of what's really going on, actually. And the defenses that we use, you know, it's just this whole preparation for time to start is just a chamber of self-deception. It's a prison of self-deception. So we need to keep emphasizing the basics. What is this situation? It is a projection of our imagination upon symbols, and we call this a dream. It's a dream simulation designed to prepare us for the start of time. And time starting would mean the beginning of the kingdom of time. For the kingdom of time to be suddenly be present. That's what this universe is. That's what bodies, worlds, nature, all of this biology, all this. This is a dream simulation. And our imagination, our creativity is so profound that it seems to be quite real to us. You know, not quite real, but still quite dazzling in its similitude of just in its, yeah, the simulation seems to be so effective, dazzling in its plausible effectiveness, you might say. In all the detail that we have put into it, it's quite dazzling. We have sweated the details over and over and over and over and over to the nth degree for this simulation to be what we believe effective. So it seems to carry this sort of a patina of effectiveness. And so we feel like we're engaged in something quite extraordinary. Quite an extraordinary adventure. Which is why we sought this idea out of trying to be greater than God, which was what it's really about. It's really just arrogance. But it's taken us on what we feel is just an extraordinary adventure. But the adventure is quite troublesome for us, for sure. And yet we continue to be dazzled by our own creativity. And we don't want to admit that that we can somehow see through our creativity. We want to believe that our creativity is so great that, you know, there isn't any way that you know, basically it can completely fool us and keep us forever fooled. But that's not really the purpose of our creativity, is to fool ourselves and keep ourselves perpetually fooled. And since that's not really the purpose that God gave creativity, we can see through it, actually. And we were not going to be perpetually fooled. So this morning I saw through it to an extraordinary degree. And, you know, I just sort of have to see what the backlash will be from that. Now, in ancient times, they talk about all the stuff that happened, and one of the motifs of ancient times, of course, there's constant war taking place, tribal wars, territorial wars. And this went on continuously all over the place. So the ones that were not as powerful and felt that you know, that someone else was going to come in and enslave them, destroy them, enslave them, take over their territory, they had to come up with ways to see if they could prevent that. And so there were various tactics that they've come up with. The ancients were very tactical and you know, transparently tactical, but it worked. A lot of these tactics worked. Something about Jacob coming back into the territory of Esau, I think his twin brother, in Jewish history. And his twin brother wanted to destroy him because Jacob had lied to the father, Isaac, and got Isaac's blessing by impersonating Esau, or I'm not sure how it's pronounced. You know, they just lie and deceive, and of course the mother was behind it. She's the one who put the whole scheme into Jacob's mind and said, "You got to do this," and pushed it through because he was her favorite. So he's coming back into the territories that he had left before, and he finds out that there's this huge army coming to destroy him. And he says, "Oh my gosh, what can we do? We're all going to be destroyed." And so he said, "Hey, let's put together all my best sheep, my flocks, and the bounty that I have, and send this all forward to greet the army coming to destroy me, so that they would, as a token of my goodwill and my humility and willingness to, you know, do things their way, and let's not fight." And you know, it worked. The twin brother said, "Wow, you know, I think it's better to do business with this Jacob than to destroy him. He looks like he's really good at producing abundance from the earth, you know, so let's do business instead. So what they really did was they tried to convince the advancing invading army, you know, it would be better to do business with them than to destroy them. Like, look at the abundance we have. Look at the value we can bring you. Look at the value that we can bring you. The other tactic, which was used quite often, is to present the fairest maiden in all the land, the most beautiful young maiden in all the land, or several of them, and say, here, you know, here is a token of our obedience to you and our love of you and affection towards you, the conquering maiden. Here, King Conqueror, you know, we're giving you the most beautiful, accomplished maiden in all the land here. And for marriage. And then this often worked, too. This often worked. And she would beg, don't destroy my people. Don't destroy my family. I'll bear you wonderful, beautiful children who will rule over great kingdoms and everything. And the king would be, you know, kind of momentarily, you know, besotted by this, you know, beautiful goddess-like maiden who could appear to be so sweet and nice. And then the king said, wow, maybe I'll invade a little bit later. Yeah, so this is, you know, this is how they operated in ancient times. They were absolutely without any conscience or scruples, whatever worked, they would do. And the amazing thing about this situation here is we are preparing for the kingdom of time. We're preparing so that when the kingdom of time suddenly appears, we think, believe it will be. Of course, it won't ever appear, but we believe it will because our arrogance tells us it will. Then we will no longer be spirit, we'll be form. And so spirit is trying to get used to form, to being form. This is why it's identifying with bodies. Because spirit believes it has to get used to being a body once the kingdom of time starts. Now, within this preparation for the kingdom of time, we've realized that we may have a problem from God, that once the kingdom of time has started, God may advance upon this kingdom and want to destroy this kingdom. And so we have been playing at this game of invasion and all this, thinking we symbolize the invader. It's actually God, truth, reality, we feel is going to pressure the kingdom of time, put pressure on us. So we're trying to figure out how to nullify this pressure that we think God, truth, reality is going to put on the kingdom of time. It's like trying to attack it. So we believe God's going to try to attack us. So we feel that this truth within us is an invader, and we think, how can we stop this invader? So we're working on this problem. And it's the old send a beautiful maiden trick to God and saying, you know, God is invading the kingdom of time. We'll send a goddess to meet God, and the goddess will say, hey, God, let's form a union. Let's form a marriage of time and no time. Let's form a marriage of lies and truth. Let's form a marriage, and together we will have beautiful children. We will have even a better creation. So we have dreamed up this scheme of the goddess, actually, which is really totally time-based, okay? But it is so alluring, so beautiful, so accomplished that God will stop and say, oh my gosh, I don't really want to destroy time because I don't want to destroy you, my lovely goddess, you know. And so this is a scheme that we have dreamed up here. And in my own life, I can absolutely corroborate this. This is exactly what happened with me. I was trying to bring in the truth of the world, and what happened? The world sent me this beautiful goddess, and I got sidetracked. It's very effective. And you say, well, I don't want to upset the goddess, and she's so conciliatory and nice to me, and say, oh, you can help her, so glad you're here, and blah 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 blah. But it's all a trick. It's a defensive system. It's probably the most effective defensive system there is the goddess defense. But again, we're just simulating this whole thing, thinking this, well, once time starts, this is what we can do. We can have these, you know, goddesses, and we'll send many to God. If one doesn't work, we'll send another. Another doesn't work, we'll send another. And we'll have millions of them we can send. And you know, the sing, they'll dance, or entertain, they'll amuse, they'll, you know, just charm the charm God, just charm God. This is what the ancients did. They send the most charming maiden that they could possibly find, and to charm the invading king. And often it worked. And then she convinced King, hey, why don't you go talk to these people? Maybe we can come up with a joint kingdom here, and our children will rule over that and all that stuff. And the king said, well, you know, maybe, yeah, could be so charmed. And it's something about this dream is we... Of course, it's all our imagination. The king is also our imagination, and we have it. We have the king fall under the spell, under the charms of this goddess, and we say, wow, this is gonna work. So when the kingdom of time starts, when God is invading, when truth is invading, which really thing is, we can't stop it because truth is within us, right? And so we feel, when in simulating the simulation, we feel like, hey, wait a minute, this is all kind of fake, isn't it? I know it's not true. And we feel that, oh, that's going to be a big problem once time starts. We might still know that time is not true. So how do we defend against this? And so we pretend that we're vulnerable to the goddess, the charms of the goddess. And then we end up saying, well, yeah, why don't I work to make, instead of destroying, showing that time is all an illusion, it doesn't exist, why don't I work towards making it seem like a better illusion, make it more beautiful and more enjoyable? Yeah, that sounds like a good plan. So the goddess tries to charm you into supporting time. So when you try to bring the truth into this dream simulation and help us wake up from this, you are viewed as an invader, and is a perfect test case to test out the goddess defense. And there's other defenses too. All the defenses are used against you, but the goddess defense is the most, the one that has been most successful. At least we've invested in it so much. The idea is to just charm God into accepting equality of truth and lies. And so then the goddess becomes the great defender of the kingdom of time. The essential defender of the kingdom of time, which is why those who are preparing for the kingdom of time ultimately become goddess worshippers, is they feel they absolutely need this goddess, this charmer, to protect them from God. And so they pray to her, they worship her, they sacrifice, they bring things in. You're great. You're so charming. Look, they look how charmed I am by you. I'm completely smitten by you. I'm completely under your spell. Therefore, you must be absolutely charming, right? And that means you can charm God too, right? And of course, what I discovered is that the goddess cannot charm God at all. God is completely oblivious to it. And that's the last thing anybody here wants to hear, right? That is for sure. Because they feel it leaves them defenseless. But of course, God is not the slightest, is oblivious to this dream of time, actually. So God's not going to invade the dream of time. Is oblivious to it, no interest. It's our own arrogance, that's all it is. Now, of course, the goddess too can cry if God decides to continue to invade, then the goddess starts weeping and wailing and moaning and says, "I'm going to tear myself to pieces if you do this. I'm going to disface my beauty." Oh, and she'll do anything at all to defend, the kingdom of time from God. And of course, the answer is there is no kingdom of time. There never will be any kingdom of time. We don't need any goddess to defend a kingdom of time that doesn't exist. And God is not vulnerable at all to being charmed in any way. But when we try to, Spirit tries to bring truth in here, then people say, "Oh, let's use this as a test case for God invading the kingdom of time, and let's try our defenses out on them." And that's what happens. So you try to come here and share the truth, and what happens is the world, this collective consciousness, simply sees this as an opportunity to test out their defenses instead of an opportunity to get free of their insanity, free of their arrogance, actually. This is what happens. Now, there's another defense that we use, and this is one of the ways to look at Jesus' crucifixion, is it can be looked at this way, in that we feel that God is going to try to destroy the kingdom of time, because actually the kingdom of time is an attempt to destroy God. Actually, it would be the destruction of God. And we think, well, what if God survives this attack on God, in reality? And then we say, okay, we came up with an idea. Let's make God flesh. If we can make God flesh, then we can kill God, because he killed the flesh, we can kill God. So that's why they say, well, we killed Jesus. You said Jesus is God, and we killed Jesus, was God made flesh, and then we killed the flesh. It means we killed God. And then we say, oh, we're safe. Now we're safe, you see? The kingdom of time is now safe. So many have taken the crucifixion of Jesus as meaning that this now proves that the kingdom of time can be protected from God, because we can kill God. Again, another defense of people saying, oh my gosh, how are we going to defend the kingdom of time? And the answer is, we don't have to. This is the gospel. This is the real good news. We don't have to defend the kingdom of time, because it will never be. It will never be. We'll never be in it. We will never be bodies. We will never be. There'll never be a kingdom of time. Not even one shred of it. So we don't have to figure out how to kill God, defend, charm God, kill God. Now, another thing, defense we do, is we try to charm the bringers of truth, those who are aware of truth, reality, into making a representation of the dream of preparing for time not to start. Try to make a painting, a song, some sort of representation, some image of it. And then we say, oh, well, we'll worship this image, that you can make. So it's so important. Thank you so much. And then gradually then they begin to this process of becoming less and less and less interested in it. And by doing that, they think that they are practicing freeing themselves from any attraction to reality, you see. So they put a huge premium on demanding some sort of representation to prove, that you're really, from heaven or from reality, by giving us a representation. They're very adamant about that. And then they pretend to be smitten by the representation, but then gradually they work on diminishing that, diminishing, diminishing, diminishing. And of course, it's easy to do that, because the experience of the dream of preparing for time never to start is this dance of the living light. The living light itself is the livingness right now, and creativityness of the light right now, spontaneity of it right now, the absolute freedom right now of this living light. This is the charm of the dream of preparing for time to never start. So it's truly charming. It charms you back to reality, is what it does. Charms you back to setting down even perception and preparation and habit altogether. And there isn't any way to statically represent that in an image. To represent it in an image would be to completely damn it with extremely faint praise. Okay. And to completely miss the whole purpose of it, which is the livingness of it. the freedom of it. It has no definition. It's dancing free of definition. It does a definition-free dance, an image-free dance. It seems as though it's definitions and images, and yet it plays with that in such a way that it keeps liberating, keeps liberating, keeps liberating. And as soon as you put anything into a static representation, you're basically completely twisting and distorting and throwing that whole situation, presentation, upside down and backwards. And then people will take that as, oh, this is an accurate representation, and then they feel they can attack it through disinterest, right? Attack it through ultimate disinterest, gradual disinterest. So it's very clever how we are defending this nonsense. So, what the ego will say, arrogance will tell you, when you start to experience the fluidity of nowness, hey, that's great, but we need a representation. We need a who needs a representation? Well, the defense system needs a representation. So I would just say, hey, if you want to experience this, then come on in. Come on in. The water is fine. Repent and experience. You must liberate your universe from the purpose you gave to it, which you can do through practice. You know, this is the liberation in the now practice. All light liberated in the now. All matter liberated in the now. All form liberated in the now. All process liberated in the now. All stones liberated in the now. All dirt liberated in the now. All water liberated in the now. Liberate your universe. All forms liberated in the now. All nature liberated in the now. All creatures liberated in the now. All bodies liberated in the now. So keep doing this liberation process. Take refuge in practice. Liberation practice. Liberate your universe. And it will be liberated into this universe of preparing us for the fact that time will never start. Preparing us for this, to accept this completely. And then don't make any representation. As I said, the winning entry is no entry. So when you make a static representation, whatever it may be, symbolic representation, then the mind says, oh, so this is how it's going to be when time starts. Okay, great. This will help us get used to the starting of time. That's what they want it for. So the defenses are so habituated. We're so habituated to these defenses that we hardly realize they're just habits. We think they're just a natural functioning of the mind that instantly is just not even instantly, is intrinsically at work. It's not so. We're actually employing these tactical defenses very quickly, and it happens so fast that we're hardly aware that we're doing it as an intentional deployment of defenses. But we have to be able to recognize and see and say, oh wow, I just suddenly I decided, oh, I need this defense. Boom, there it is. We're so habituated to it. We have managed to get reactions to happen very fast, very quickly, which is quite deceptive for us, quite deceptive. This is not level, is it? Let me see. If I can get that better. I don't know. Okay. There you go. So again, when we see things are a little bit off like that, then straighten it out. Is it straight yet? I guess so. Yeah. Straighten it out quickly. Straighten it out. Straighten it out. Take refuge in your practice. Take refuge in your practice. Now, we have this pride, thinking like, wow, we've done such a great job fooling ourselves that we want to see what this is like. You know, well, we're already feeling what it's like. It's like history. That's what it's been like. It's terrible. We already know what it's like. And when we keep thinking, no, it must be better than that. You know, I just want to hold on to all these defenses for a little while longer because I think they're going to produce something that I really like, you know. Well, this is exactly the same attitude that we have had throughout history. this is history, is wait a little longer. I want to find out the good part of these defenses. There must be some, you know, something really good come of all this stuff, and it hasn't happened yet, so I got to wait a little longer. I mean, it's my creativity. I know it must have a really positive outcome, right? And so we wait a little longer. So all that we call history is just wait a little longerness. It's not really history, it's wait a little longerness. Moment by moment. It's simply history has just been moment by moment, just let me wait a little longer. Right now. Let me wait just a little bit longer. Maybe just a couple more moments and then okay. Then wait right now. Let me a few more moments. Right now, a little longer. Not quite ready. I think I've just almost got the positiveness of it. I almost have it. So let me just wait a little longer. This goes on indefinitely. It will, as long as we take this wait a little longer attitude, our misery will continue, plain and simple. However long we keep this position, that's how long our misery will continue. Now, bringing these defenses to light is quite a shock. It's a wow. So that's what's been tripping me up. And so use the full stop in the wow practice where you just say, okay, just let it be. Okay, it's fine. We're just going to let it be now, all right? I'm not going to extrapolate. Just neutral. See, for us, pretending to get trying to get ready for time, reality seems to be this huge, invincible, mighty force that can destroy our plans, you know, and so we try to find some way to nullify that, and we've used these defenses, and the goddess defense throughout history. We've imagined this probably should help work. It should work, even though God has mighty armies advancing. That all we have to do is charm God, and the God will say to all the mighty armies, say, you know, stand back. I've decided not to attack. I'm too happy right now with this charming maiden, and I don't really feel like slaughtering a bunch of people right now. So. And of course, then other aggressive invaders know about this tactic, so they try to train themselves so it wouldn't be effective on them. Like the Spartans, you know, the Spartans. Yeah, Alexander the Great, you know, did not succumb to this sort of tactic. He succumbed to the tactic of saying, "Hey, we'll if you don't attack us, we'll give you presence that'll enable you to be even more successful as an invader. But just don't invade us." And that was, of course, in India, where the empire at that time. They gave him all these war elephants. And also, you know, all sorts of ability to be even more powerful in battle, and in exchange, he agreed not to, you know, invade that area. So that's another tactic. So the tactic will say, "Hey, God, you know, you're attacking time. I'll tell you what, you know, we really admire you're such a great warrior, you know, a great conqueror. You're awesome, and we recognize that we can't withstand you, but." You know, what we want you, we're going to help you be even more awesome and even more formidable. And we're going to give you all these, you know, weapons here. And then you'll be able to you know, invade and destroy even more enemies, God, but just, you know, leave us in our little kingdom of time alone. And so we think we can make that deal with God. So we're inventing all these weapons, advanced weapon systems, you know. So when God invades, we'll say, hey, God, look what we have for you. Let us give you these, you know. Let's make a deal. Again, we have to realize that everything that history that we've been going through, this planet, everything in this universe, is a dream, is our own dream. It is a dream. So we simply fashion the dream the way we want to fashion it. And we fashion it in a way to try to figure out how to deal with the threats to the kingdom of time. Once we believe it starts, we feel that we're starting to, we isolate a whole bunch of threats. We say, wow, it feels very threatened for some reason. How do we get rid of this feeling of threat? Because we're not happy feeling threatened. And of course, the kingdom of time is the threat we feel is that it can never be real, can never start, can never be. So it can only be just a figment of our imagination, which is completely vulnerable to truth. So we try to imagine ways to get rid of this threat, which is why history seems so bizarre. Like, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? And we're still doing it nonstop, more than ever. So another way that we've done it is we've pronounced through our arrogance, just decreed that bodies are God's children, that God created all these bodies. So that when God invades, we can say, hey, God, we're your direct ancestors. You created us. We're your children. You don't want to kill your children, do you? And so we've made up this nonsense that bodies are God's creation, that God's children, because it feels that would protect. I think that might protect against the threat that time would be under. Yeah. And of course, let me think. What if God says, "Well, how did I conceive you? I don't remember conceiving you." He says, "Well, God, all these children were immaculately conceived. You immaculately conceived them all." All these bodies. God says, really? I don't think so. But we make up all these stories and things to try and defend against threat. And then we dignify and institutionalize these defense systems. And so when you start seeing this, you realize that all of history just comes unraveled. Everything we've done here comes unraveled. You say, wow, it's just been a crazy simulation of trying to, ahead of time, trying to figure out, get rid of the threat to the kingdom of time. The vulnerability. How do we, you know, make it invulnerable? From what? From truth. From God. From reality. And we can't figure out any way to establish it without some feeling of threat, because, of course, the establishment would just be in our own arrogant imagination, which is what we're doing right now. There's no such thing as time. Never will be. Meaning that there's no such thing as imprisonment. That if our freedom is free, there'll never be a lack of freedom in reality. And so eventually you see why the whole thing is just a dream. Wow. I place so much value on it. And now I see it, that the whole thing is just this madcap attempt to defend against God, defend lies against truth. When you live in the kingdom of lies, you're going to feel threatened by truth. So we try to figure out, how can we make a deal with truth? How can we charm truth? How can we buy truth off? How can we, you know, and so we're just putting on this little play here that we call the world and universe and this bodies. It's just a little play. And we play different roles acting out this threat, and then the response to the threat here. It's just all a play. As Shakespeare said, it's all a play signifying, full of sound and fury, signifying absolutely nothing. That's true. And what we're doing is we're acting out in our imagination this imagined vulnerability and response to the vulnerability. So, of course, you have to have victim, victimizer in this play. You have these, have to have these different roles. Like, oh, I'm the poor, vulnerable lie. And here comes the powerful, you know, angry truth. And truth is trying to destroy the lie. But how? So how do we run to the protection of this poor, vulnerable lie? You know, and let's figure out ways to defeat this horrible truth. And as I've always said, that victim and victimizer are in cahoots. Just the way actors or actresses will know what the script is in a movie or play. So one person says, oh, give them the script of the villain. They read their script and say, okay, I'm supposed to do this. Oh, okay. And the other's given the script of the heroine, the vulnerable, you know, damsel in distress. She goes, okay, I'm supposed to act this, okay. And then they act out this scene. Here comes the terrible victimizer, and the victim screaming, ah, you know, help, you know, trying to come up with some way. And then she, you know, finally figures out a very clever, devious way to get free of the terrible victimizer, you know. And then we in our dream, we say, oh, you know, good, maybe this will work. Maybe this will work against God. When the time comes, when the kingdom of time starts, maybe we'll be able to, you know, use this. So we're trying to come up with some sort of successful strategy. And we continue to act out all this drama here, symbolizing our fears of what might happen in the kingdom of time, like what the threat will be like. So in order to, you know, try out, it's a simulation, in order to see what might work, we like put the simulation on, and then, but ultimately we're controlling everything. We're controlling everything. We're just reaching a plausible conclusion of what we think might work, and we think we might be able to charm God into turning away from time and letting it be. So we think the goddess defense will work. But it's just all our imagination. There's zero truth to any of it. There's no foundation in reason to any of it whatsoever, because time will never start. It's utterly meaningless what we're doing here, completely meaningless. And of course, if you want to really be helpful here, you can't fall into these traps or fool around with it. You just have to be very forthright and speak the truth. And the truth is, you're going to come into the camp of truth eventually. Everyone is. So sooner or later, everyone is going to abandon all these simulated defensiveness, this foolishness, and accept that truth is true. So why not do it now? Sooner or later, everyone's going to do it, so why not do it now? See, why not do it sooner rather than later? This is just the most appealing question, isn't it? This is the best appeal. Like, if something is inevitable, you're going to do it sooner or later for sure, why not do it sooner? What else needs to be said? Now, one of the stumbling blocks we still have is we say, wow, if I take this hard line on all these defenses, that means I won't entertain the charming goddess. I'll just say no. Go back to your, the king just say no. I'm not interested. Go back to your people. Don't waste my time. I'm not going to spend any moments. I'm not going to entertain you at all. And then just God will start crying, but look how talented, look how beautiful. Just say, forget it. Go. Not interested. And then we think, oh my gosh, what did I do? I could have spent, you know, millions of years being entertained by this goddess, and it would have been so intriguing, and you know. But the truth is that when we liberate our universe from the purpose of helping us prepare for the kingdom of time, we now use the universe for preparing us to realize that time will never start. There will never be a kingdom of time. The light will entertain us to an immeasurably more satisfying extent than any god, goddess could. To an immeasurably more satisfying extent than any goddess could ever entertain us. Any figment of our imagination of time, space, process, and form. Because what it entertains us with is freedom, whereas what the goddess entertains us with is time, is lack of freedom. Trying to make lack of freedom seem charming, and it doesn't really work within us. We're saying, "Huh, you know, it's just something that's kind of stale about this." So we can get strung along. But if we're really honest, we can say that all of history has never been appealing. There's nothing that's ever been appealing in this dream of preparing for time. Nothing has ever been really appealing. Even the greatest goddesses have never been really appealing. Whereas the living light in the dream of preparing for time to never start, this appeals to us because it keeps showing us our freedom from the symbols of time, space, process, and form. And remember the idea that, well, all this is going to be destroyed, you know. What's this? This is just an imaginary scenario we're imagining. There's nothing can be destroyed. In reality, the rising and sustaining and subsiding is all one play of pure potential. There's no manifest and no unmanifest. It's all the same, actually. There's no dividing lines anywhere. It's seamless. So you cannot talk about destruction in the way of your imagination. Just symbolic figments of our imagination is not destruction. It's just we realize it has no purpose, has no use, it's meaningless. It's meaningless. It's always been meaningless. It's nothing. So how can you destroy nothing? I mean, there's nothing there to destroy. Even if you look at it that way, I mean, the it's never been appealing. So what lament do we have to return to pure potential? What has never had any appeal to us? No real appeal at all. A denial of what we are. That doesn't really have an appeal. Just a zero. examine all this, we go into shock to a certain extent. Go into shock. Because we don't not quite sure what's going to happen next. Shock is a protection against what we think is going to happen or might happen or what has happened. We're not sure what has happened. When we see all this, we're not sure. Did I injure myself? Did I harm myself? Am I going to be harmed? Shock is this great protector from what we think might be harm or trouble of some sort. And we see this all the time in accidents and various things like that, where the people come out and they say, "I'm fine, I'm okay," and they're really not, but they go into shock and they seem to be able to function for a while, okay, but then maybe there's a delayed reaction, some later, hours later, or a day later, or even 2 days later, suddenly, you know, the shock wears off and they suddenly just break down in great fear or something. So, we do go into sort of a shock mode. And we say, maybe I severely harmed myself, I'm not even aware of it, so I better just go into shock. And then gradually the shock wears off and you realize, oh, I didn't harm myself at all, just the opposite. That's part of it. So when you go into the shock mode, the wow mode, just say, okay, I'm in the wow mode. And identify what's going on. Say, okay, I just made so many breakthroughs that I'm worried that maybe I might be experiencing just great bliss and I'm afraid of that, or I might be been harmed by this, I'm not sure. So let me just be in neutral here and not sort of feel anything at all for a while. Just this wowness. Because seeing these very basic defenses, the all-important defenses, and seeing through how silly they are, this makes us feel like, wow, I'm without, you know, all my most important defenses. You know, what's going to happen to me? What's going to happen? I don't know. I'm not sure. Wow. We're really, at some level, we're not quite sure. Now, a lot of prayer is really directed towards trying to see if we can't find a way to protect ourselves from God. And so we're so desperate, like we're praying to the invader, you know, invader, can you please at least have mercy upon us? Please have mercy upon us, invader. You know, we don't want to be destroyed. Is there any mercy you might have, or is anybody around you that might know some merciful way of mercy? And so we use the old ploy of, well, God doesn't have any mercy, but some of God's chief lieutenants know that he's got a weakness, and so if we pray to them, they'll intercede for us with God. And, you know, that's the old Virgin Mary thing, said yes, goddess thing. It's the goddess saying, please, you know, goddess, you know, please intercede on our behalf. We'll worship you forever if you do that. And thinking that the goddess knows the weakness of God and will go to God and charm God or something and into not attacking. It's the same goddess, same variation on the goddess defense. And of course, God is not attacking us at all. God is paying no judgment whatsoever on our silly dream. God that doesn't defend reality. God simply knows reality. So God just knows that we're perfect, and there's nothing we can do about that. We can't change it. So what does God need to judge? Our efforts to change it? No. And God knows that we cannot change it, because God did not create us to be able to change it. And God's will is perfect. and unchanging. So God is not defending anything, not judging anything, saying, hey, that you know, defense looks better than the other one, or this effort to attack rally seems to be, could be more dangerous than this other one. Or there's no judgment from God taking place at all. But in order to believe that we can start time at all, we have to believe that we can induce God into judgment. And so then we believe once time starts, we also will have a judgmental God. See, we can't get away from this duality. This is our problem. In order for us to believe that time could ever start to be a kingdom of time, we have to believe that we are able to induce God into judgment in some way. That God, and therefore God says, oh, you know, yeah, time, that is a threat to reality. that has actually attacked. I have been attacked. I'm judging that I've been attacked. And so then we feel we will have a angry, vengeful God coming after us for having attacked the kingdom. His kingdom. You see, in order for us to believe that time can start, we have to believe that that reality can be attacked and yet not destroyed by this attack. Because if we destroyed reality, we realize that we would be destroyed too. We would be destroyed too, because we are one with reality. So we have to feel that time is not the destruction of reality, but a severe attack upon reality, which leaves God severely crippled and us in an ascendant, you know, position. Time in an ascendant position. But then, of course, we have this problem of thinking, wow, God must be very wounded, but very angry and vindictive and plotting revenge against us. And then we have to figure out, how do we protect ourselves from this vengeful God? So this is why our minds have been caught up in this scenario, dreaming about this scenario, trying to model it, simulate what we think is going to happen. This is a pretty big wow, isn't it? I hadn't seen it this way before, this clearly. This sort of ties it all together. In order to believe that we can have a millennium in this simulation, we have to believe that God's been so charmed by the goddess that God is just sort of like saying, well, I'm not so angry or vengeful anymore. I'm sort of enjoying my crushing defeat. The goddess has made it all worthwhile for me. And so we're praying to the goddess so much now as we come close to what many want to believe is the millennium. We're investing great hope and faith and trust in the goddess, saying that, you know, she will succeed in her mission to charm God into submission for at least 1,000 years. So we can finally enjoy our little dream here, you know, without worrying about the threat. But of course, as our dissatisfaction grows, we project that onto our goddess and say, wow, she's losing influence over God. Or project it onto God and say, the goddess is losing her influence over God. It's not so charming anymore. So we'll go through frantic worshiping and sacrifices to the goddess and all this nasty stuff that comes later, and desperately trying to convince her of our need for her to be more charming. And we don't realize that it's all our own dissatisfaction that we're projecting upon God, making it think that God is starting to get angry again at us. Or as we try to then make the dream permanent, we feel that this arouses God to great anger, because it's, you know, attempt to completely wipe him out, for God, wipe God out forever, and then God's going to furiously attack us for this, and then we go back into this extreme defensive mode like that. And this is the hell of this dream. This dream is really hellish, actually, very hellish. So the remedy for all this is practice. Take refuge in practice. I am now. I am now. I am not this tree. I am now. I am not this world. I am now. I am not this universe. I am now. I am not this landscape. I am now. I am not this river. I am now. I am not this ocean. I am now. I am not this body. I am now. Ocean liberated in the now. Fish liberated in the now. All sea creatures liberated in the now. All phytoplankton liberated in the now. All algae liberated in the now. All salt liberated in the now. So the way to go from this paranoid condition of trying to figure out what's going to work to protect us from an angry God, to changing the dream to one of preparing us for time to never start, where then you don't have any angry, vengeful God, because time's never going to start. So there's never going to be any so-called attack upon God. So we don't need defenses against God, right? So we have to practice this as we shift, as we liberate our universe and give it a different purpose. Practice this already. Practice this. I already know the light has already come. The light is already dancing its dance of freedom and love for me. Yes, I'm already experiencing the dance of the living light. Yes, I am already experiencing the dance of the living light. The freedom dance of the living light. And this light will show us that all form that we think is form are just dream imagery that the light is simulating for us. And yet the light shows that it's not bound by any of this. It's not bound by any of it. So it shows you its intrinsic freedom, that it is not bound. We're just insisting on this simulation. So, you reach a point, I can say this information that I've put out in this video so far has just about knocked me out. Couple that with everything this morning. And you talk about a full course meal. The key is to not be knocked out by it. So you'd say, well, okay, this is very intense, and the wow is very intense, but I'm not going to be knocked out by it. I'm okay. But it's amazing. I slept until noon, tried to get as much rest as possible, on and off. I was dozing on and off and try. And right now, what is it? It's like 2 o'clock and I'm suddenly feeling very tired. This is because of the effort and the reaction to this information, this wow reaction. Yeah, I know there's all sorts of go-getters out there, like especially in Silicon Valley, where, you know, real estate agents are bringing in massive amounts of money every year, and I mean, it's boom times, go. People out there just, you know, like on weekends, oh, just crazy. And here I am, very sluggishly, you know, staying in bed till noon, tired right now at 2. But the amount of progress that's been made is off the charts. I wouldn't trade the progress I've made today for all the money in the universe, all the power in the universe, which I now see as just complete farce, sham. So who's really making the money, so to speak? The real money that we want is freedom. Recognize our freedom. We think that we've found a way to bind our freedom, making us greater than God, but we haven't. This is just a make-believe simulation of imprisonment. It's like we're dreaming a dream of being imprisoned in this incredibly high-security prison, and we're so like wowed by it, like wow. I never knew I could imprison myself, but I did, you know. And then we realizing ultimately we didn't. Just a dream. How can a dream of imprisonment imprison the dreamer? Can it really imprison the dreamer? No. It only seems that way as long as the dreamer plays along, wants to pretend that it's imprisoned. But when it decides it's through pretending that it's imprisoned, the dream has no power whatsoever. And we realize it never had power. It's only our own desire to pretend that we're in prison at play. Never any true imprisonment whatsoever. See, the light cannot imprison us. We're spirit. We're the will of God, part of the will of God and extension of the will of God. And so what we desire to experience, the light provides for us. You call it love provides for us. The light, the love, living light provides for us. So it has no power to bind us, nor can it bind itself. It's our servant. How can a servant bind itself and then claim, oh, I bound myself, I cannot do what you asked me to do? Is that a perfect servant? No, it is not. So the light cannot bind itself. It's our perfect servant. And again, if it could bind itself, it wouldn't be our perfect servant. It would say, oh, I really want to serve you so much, but geez, something terrible happened to me and I'm bound. Some force came upon me. I don't know where it came from, but it bound me. I'm not able to respond to your request anymore. This whole thing is a response to our request. We requested light to claim that there's some force that bound it, and it can't respond to our requests anymore. and then it's bound to this dream. Ah, a little breeze here. A little cooler today. Yesterday it hit 98. Today it's supposed to hit, might get up to what, 94, 95. But it's a nice little breeze. It's going to cool down tomorrow a bit, actually. So you can feel it. Ocean breeze is making its way over here now. Yesterday was very still, very hot. So again, when these realizations arise, you just say, oh, okay, just go along with it and just stay calm and when you need to, neutral mode, full stop on the wow mode. So you see, this level of looking at the situation is so superior to politics or anything like that. They completely miss it. Completely miss what's really going on. Even though politics has some connection, I mean, well, it doesn't really have connection with waking up from the dream at all. It's just simulating the kind of threats and problems we think that we will have and how to effectively control the kingdom of time so there's not rebellion in the kingdom of time. We feel there's going to be rebellion, people won't like it. So we're trying to develop a one-world bureaucracy, actually, that is a super intense, vicious bureaucracy. And we're trying to make everyone dependent on the workings of this bureaucracy. Like a vast federalism throughout the planet. One vast federalism. This is what we're working towards. Feeling that this is how we'll have to be when time starts. King of time, this is the necessary way that we need to keep ourselves in line. Of course, we haven't had anything quite this severe because we've been considering that maybe time, you know, won't start. Maybe we can be saved from this. So I say, let's not, we don't need to quite go that far, you know. Or you might say we've been using other defenses and they don't quite work so well. Or we think they have worked well, and so time's just about ready to start. So now we have to dot our I's and cross our T's and make sure that we have a way to control the population here. And the way to do it, what they're doing in the United States, trying to do, it was just blocked by the House of Representatives. They're trying to push this trade agreement through with Asia, which would basically totally subvert our economy and workers here, and enable the bureaucrats to enact any laws they want to without judicial necessary judicial oversight and agreement, so they can put everybody out of work here. And what they're doing is they're trying to reassure us that don't worry, we'll increase the safety net of the welfare, food stamps, and the safety net for those who are put out of work by this. Meaning, don't worry, we'll make them dependent upon the government for their life, but we'll take care of them. And ultimately their goal is to try to make, you know, everybody dependent on the government for their life. So that they can't, you know, don't dare speak up against the government. There's no ability to do so. See, the idea of having independent income, independent of the bureaucracy, and it's your own income, is so that you cannot be bullied and intimidated and because you say, well, I can survive if you don't like what I'm doing, so what? My money's good. I can go buy a car, I can buy food. You can't do anything about it. So that's what they're trying to get rid of. And this trade agreement was a very powerful way they were aiming that, and it got temporarily stopped. In other words, they're not completely insane yet. The bureaucracy and the head of bureaucracy certainly are. They're absolutely all in on this. This is the cornerstone of their idea of success, of how are we going to govern the kingdom of time? Well, make sure that everybody's completely dependent on a centralized dictatorship is how we feel it has to be governed. How arrogance feels it must be governed. And there's no, you know, because we realize, hey, we really can't solve the problems of time. It's people are going to feel threatened. They're not going to like it. So we got to be able to intimidate them into compliance. So, but they're basically saying is, yeah, you're going to lose your job, but don't worry. We'll make sure you have food stamps. And of course, if you give us trouble, we'll cut off your food stamps. If you criticize the government, we'll cut off your welfare. Whereas in a free society where people, you know, have access to their own money and jobs, they say, well, we can say anything we want to about the government. They can't prevent me from living. There's all sorts of banking laws that have been instituted now, which is preventing people from having access to their money. they could only take out so much, transfer so much, et cetera, without this, you know, governmental oversight. So they're ultimately they're going to watch every penny that you have is basically going to be based on bureaucratic oversight. This is the, and so why are we doing this? To tie this in, why is this? Because we feel the time is about ready to start, and we need a system of governments we feel is really going to work. And we feel that freedom here isn't going to work in the kingdom of time. But it's not going to work. It'll be too ragged, you know. People might start saying, wait a minute. I don't really like this kingdom of time. I want to find something better. And they say, no, that will give courage to God. You might join God's army to try to invade the kingdom of time. We can't have you doing that. We got to make you completely dependent on the government of the kingdom of time. So if you try to join forces with God, we can absolutely cut you off instantly, pull the plug on you instantly. So they want to make sure everyone is plugged in to this vast bureaucracy so that the plug can be instantly pulled if necessary. And they're adamantly working towards that goal. And the legislator said, oh my gosh, if we go along with this, we're going to lose our jobs. We'll get voted out of office. So they decided, better not. This is going a little too fast. I think they might be wise to us. But they'll get around it some way. This is the crown jewel of this administration's efforts to fashion a one-world government, which is believed is the only way to deal with the troubles that the kingdom of time will have. And of course, our answer to that is the kingdom of time will never start. So it's all meaningless, moot exercise, a pointless exercise, actually. Folly. Absolute folly. No need for this exercise. Well, no need to take refuge in this, in politics. Take refuge in spiritual practice. This has always been the truth. Now, using this terminology, you say, well, it sounds kind of Buddhist, take refuge in the practice. Well, yeah, it is kind of Buddhist because I've certainly been helped by a great Buddhist, a Longchenpa. But the overall context of what I'm saying is very Christian, which is Jesus, for me, has the very best full context clarity. And so fundamentally, from the standpoint of context, I'm talking the talk of Jesus, absolutely. And then also acknowledging that the great importance of taking refuge in practice, which is what Buddha emphasized, take refuge in practice. This is absolutely true. That's what we have to take refuge in. And as a society, this is where we're failing. Because yes, you can have the context clear, but the continuity issues require you to take refuge somewhere. If you don't take refuge in practice, you're going to take refuge in defensiveness. You'll just find a more clever defense. You'll take refuge in the goddess is what will happen. This is what happened to me. I was very clear about the context that Jesus was talking about. Not very clear, but some of the Course in Miracles, somewhat clear. But I didn't practice enough. And so I ended up then, because of the continuity fear, because it got so strong, I said, I got to take refuge somewhere from this content. It's so strong. And so I ended up taking refuge in the goddess, which, you know, big mistake. So I say the way to avoid taking refuge in defensiveness, a very clever defensiveness, ultimately the goddess defense, is right practice, right practice. Buddhists have very little refuge in the goddess. You know, it's still around the fringes, etc. there, but they take refuge in just practice. They're supposed to, at least. That's the idea. And Christians are, quite derelict in this. This is the shortcoming of Christianity is the Christians have I think a wider contextual understanding. The Trinity is a very important contextual understanding, but they don't practice nearly enough. They tend to lapse into the Jesus died for me defense, saying we killed God, so if we just keep believing that we did that, then we should be free of any threat in time. You know, that should free us from any threat from God. because God agreed to be killed for the sake, you know, they say God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten son, meaning God so loved time, the kingdom of time, or is going to love the kingdom of time so much that he showed that he was willing to die so that the kingdom of time can live. You know, this is, you know, this is a defense. So my practicing received a great boost from meeting Longchenpa, the great, one of the greatest practicers ever, actually. You might call him a master of practice. He is supremely skilled at all practices, spiritual practices. And from that point on, I've been practicing, you know, to a tremendous extent, just to become a tremendous practitioner. It's not always the time you put in, it's also the quality. And a lot of these practices are extremely high-quality practices. And if you just do them for a while, you know, it's going to be very beneficial for you. So I certainly credit Longchenpa with helping motivate this, absolutely. And but the, you know, the overall credit certainly goes to Jesus for putting the, you know, showing us the, how the entire situation fits together, you know, and the entire context, and giving us practices as well, a lot of practices. A Course in Miracles has a lot of practices, 365, one for every day. Now, you don't have to do those particular practices. I wasn't enamored of them too much, but they're all good. They're all good practices. There's no doubt about it. Certainly have done some of them, but these various other practices that I feel are, you know, I'm able to get into them, so the potency is brought to bear very strongly. But if you get into any right practice, if you put your intensity into it, you're going to get, that's what you're going to get out of it. You're going to get success out of it. Any right practice, not defensiveness under the guise of worship and prayer, etc. Like, God, we're doing real good in the here in the kingdom of time, and we know this is that you just this is your pet project for us. So could you please show us how we could do better and please you more, so you won't get angry at us and attack us and say, "Hey, you're not doing so good there. I think I'm going to bring you back into reality." You know, all that's not right practice. It's not right practice at all. Now, there have been times when practice in Christianity was much stronger than it is now. Same with Buddhism. There, you know, used to be that practice was very intense. It's not as intense now at all. So we've collectively we've dropped the ball on taking refuge in right practice. We've dropped the ball on it. It's very difficult to get anybody, as I have experienced. It's as if I can't get anybody, can't inspire anyone to practice whatsoever. That's how far we've fallen. And again, the continuity fear is going to bite you, and you'll end up taking refuge in a clever defense, which often is the goddess defense. This is what will happen. So when the day comes, you say, "Wow, this isn't working out very good for me. This whole goddess defense thing is like, wow, it's just bringing hell down on my head," which it will. Then remember what's said here is take refuge in right practice, and start asking the Holy Spirit for practice ideas, and pray for some compassionate great practitioner to help you out, which is all I did. And Longchenpa showed up. I didn't have any idea who Longchenpa was. Never heard of him. You know, label name made no impression upon me whatsoever. And he didn't even say what his name was. Didn't matter. Doesn't matter, right? doesn't matter what your name is. It's do you have, can you take refuge in practice? That's what matters. So I was given a glimpse of pure spaciousness, and then the idea came to me that by practicing I could, you know, abide in this awareness. And so then I started asking the Holy Spirit for what to practice more. So I really became, and the Holy Spirit gave me these better and better practices. So you can do the same. You can do the same. If you go happen to fall into some clever defense, if you don't practice, you certainly will fall into some clever defense, then just keep in mind that you can get out of that through right practice, through taking refuge in practice, and certainly call out for all enlightened beings to respond. If anyone wants to help you, please respond, and someone will help you. That's all I did, and I did it for the world. I said, please, the world really needs help now, so if there's anyone who wants to help, I'll go along with that, you know. And Longchenpa then showed up in a dream, and I recognize this is someone that's quite profound. And then finding out about just how profound, I was just like, wow, this, you know, this one was renowned for absolute mastery of everything, all practices, just total master of what needs to be done in terms of pragmatically, you know, getting it done, practicing, taking refuge in practice. And he said, hey, don't get involved in the politics of the times. Live in a cave and practice. Don't surround yourself with a bunch of friends that waste your time, and, you know, practice, practice, practice. Don't seek fame or fortune. Practice. Take refuge in practice. This is, he would say, this is my heartfelt advice for you. And it's very good advice. So it's helpful. I mean, it helps Jesus out, because Jesus says the same thing. He says, if you study A Course in Miracles but don't practice, it's not going to work for you. But for some reason, Christians are very adverse to practicing. They say, all I got to do is to believe in Jesus. That's enough. I don't have to do any practice. So it's a big problem. Still, to this day, I mean, all I can see from A Course in Miracles people who engage in that is, you know, a lot of dialogue, a lot of talking, and maybe a little bit of practicing. I don't see this taking refuge in practiceness. You know, that's not what I'm picking up on at all. I think that's why Jesus told me, avoid all that, because you're so good at explanation, etc., that people will just say, wow, all you have to do is listen to him and we got it. And Jesus says, you'll miss it then. You'll fail. He says, you got to get to the point where you're taking refuge in practice. And I would have been distracted away from that, you know, by premature, you know, people, fanboys, fangirls thinking, wow, we have someone here who can explain it to us and we can talk about it. So it's all about taking refuge in practice. That's the ultimate goal of our continuity bridge here. It's a continuity bridge to abiding in the highest habit of all, the dream of preparing us to realize that time will never start. That's the highest habit. There isn't any habit beyond that. That is the highest habit. Beyond that, we drop all habits, even that habit. So, but our goal is to have the highest habit, the very best habit, which is taking refuge in the dream of preparing us for that time will never start. Preparing us to realize that time will never start. Preparing us to accept that time will never start. Preparing us to be comfortable with the fact that time will never start. That's the highest habit there is. And we can absolutely reach that habit. But we have to take refuge in practicing as we work through this continuity issues of, wow, seeing that, you know, as we liberate our universe from the demands we placed upon it, the dream of preparing us for time, we we, as we've been liberating this, we see, oh my gosh, there goes that defense. I see that one. And it's like, wow, I'm losing my whole defense system here. You know, it's wow. So take refuge in practicing. Full stop in the wow is a very good practice. Very, very important habit to have. And get better and better at that habit. And that will ultimately lead to the best habit, the highest habit. So throughout all my videos, there's so many, 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 many practices. But you can ask the Holy Spirit to give you a practice if you want to. Just suggest a practice to you and then do it and become really, really good at it. Good at it means when you can call it like that and you're very proficient at it. And, you know, it's a go-to move for you. And the one of castigating yourself as, and also praising is very helpful too, because a lot of times when you get in this wowness, you know, you feel like you get worried and say, maybe you're just a complete idiot. So I say, you know, hey, you know, you're a complete idiot. Act as if somebody's calling you this. You are a complete idiot. You know that? I say, yes, I am a complete idiot and I know that. Yes, I know that. Yes, I know that I am a complete idiot. But say it in a very positive, like, this is great. Yeah, it's great to be a complete idiot like this. Hey, you know, do you know that you're ruining your life? Yes, I know that I'm ruining my life. As if this were a really great thing. You know, yeah, what I'm doing is really great. However you want to label it. So, you know, a lot of the labeling will be very negative. And the positive labeling will just be to try and jerk you around so that you're afraid of losing the positive labeling. So you, then you fight, you know, struggle against the negative labeling. So, hey, do you realize that what you're doing is like the best thing ever? Yes, I realize that what I'm doing is the best thing ever. But you do realize that you're completely deluded, right? Yes, I realize that I'm completely deluded. Again, with the attitude of like I'm doing something. What I'm doing is just great. It's wonderful. I'm loving it. And so this brings us feeling like I love what I'm doing. You know, even though all this negativity is trying to pull me down. So just bring this negativity to light and just say, yeah, whatever you want to say, I love it. So you are trying to ruin everybody. Yes, I'm trying to ruin everybody. You know, the ego keeps trying to characterize it in some dastardly way. They'll try to flatter you. So, hey, do you realize that you're someone very special, some very special spiritual person? You realize that? Yes, I realize I'm some very special spiritual person. And wow, what you're doing, nobody else can do. Yes, what I'm doing, nobody else can do. Or you're just a total bum. You know, you're just mumbling a bunch of nonsense. Yes, I'm just a total bum mumbling a bunch of nonsense. So the ego will just throw every characterization at you it can to try to knock you off track, knock you off the wow, knock you off your neutrality here as you absorb the shock of your breakthrough. So you just do the yes, play the yes game here. Very helpful practice. You do realize that nobody cares what you're saying. Yes, I realize that nobody cares what I'm saying. You do realize that nobody's listening to you. Yes, I realize that nobody's listening to me. You do realize that nobody's practicing at all. Yes, I realize that nobody's practicing at all. So you do realize this is completely futile. Yes, I realize that this is completely futile. Well, you must be an idiot then. Yes, I must be an idiot then. Only a fool would keep doing this. Yes, only a fool would keep doing this. Well, you're still doing it. Yes, I'm still doing it. Oh, you must be a great fool then. Yes, I must be a great fool. Well, you should do something different then. Yes, I should do something different then. You should abandon your efforts. Yes, I should abandon my efforts. It's obvious that if no one's practicing, you must be mistaken. Yes, it's obvious if no one's practicing, I must be mistaken. So, you've decided to quit, right? Yes, I've decided to quit. Well, that's very good then. Yes, that's very good. You see, what the ego is really trying to do is get you off this wow neutrality, induce judgment into you, instead of just sitting in this non-judgmental wow condition as we get used to this great breakthroughs we've had. You're really overestimating yourself. Yes, I'm really overestimating myself. Or, you're really severely underestimating yourself. You could go so much faster. Yes, I'm severely underestimating myself. I could go so much faster. I mean, you should just, you know, keep pushing right now. Don't stop. Yes, I should just keep pushing right now. Don't stop. So by agreeing, just agreeing, you're just staying steady. You're not going anywhere, are you? You're just staying steady. So this nullifies the ego's cleverness in trying to, you know, overwhelm you. And then get it to believe that God can be induced into judgment, and that you're not taking refuge in practice, which means you'll take refuge in one of the ego's defenses, arrogance's defenses, which are quite clever. So you need to intermix your practicing with your considerations and your daily life, because the pressure is on us intensely. It's not like you can just take a break from the pressure in this world. It's not possible. You have to take refuge somewhere. Take refuge from the pressure. And practicing gives you this refuge in the pressure. If you just practice, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This begins to stabilize, and you feel great relief. Because, of course, the body, belief that we're a body, is just the simulation for the preparation for time, the kingdom of time, believing that when time starts, I will have to be a body. So I'm not a body right now at all. See, we're just identifying with this body as a way of trying to prepare for what we believe is a time, the kingdom of time, when we'll have to be a body. But, you know, right now, we are not bodies at all. So I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me right now. And right now will always be all there is right now. There'll never be time. So when we say, right now, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is a truism, this is a truism, this is a truism. Very powerful. Jesus said it's the most powerful, effective practice of all. Is to say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me, and to repeat this as much as possible during the day and night, as much as possible. Keep repeating this. And from this, you will find you'll begin to liberate your universe from this, from its purpose, and give it a different purpose. You will begin to be able to practice like, hey, tree, liberated in the now. Hey, house, liberated in the now. You're driving along, hey, asphalt, liberated in the now. You see a wall, hey, wall, liberated in the now. A piece of concrete, hey, concrete, liberated in the now. And just speak to it, and tell it, inform it. I got the great news for you, concrete. You are liberated in the now. You are right now liberated in the now. You are released in the now. Concrete, released in the now. See, there's no dialogue or deal with concrete. You are the one who frees it from the purpose that you gave to it. It didn't give itself its own purpose at all. So, stucco, released in the now. Styrofoam, released in the now. Metal can, released in the now. Whatever you have, whatever you're around, release it in the now. See, this is taking refuge in practice, in right practice. A car, released in the now. Upholstery, released in the now. Rubber, released in the now. Chrome, released in the now. Plastic, released in the now. Gasoline, released in the now. Oil, released in the now. Antifreeze, released in the now. Atmosphere, released in the now. Accidents, released in the now. Scarcity, released in the now. Victimization, released in the now. Poverty, released in the now. Light, released in the now. So it's either this or, taking refuge in the defenses of the ego of arrogance, and we know how that's working out as far as this vast, one world, new world order. Absolutely, that's coming very fast, along with all the other very tricky defenses. There's a massive array of defenses that you will get sucked into believing that this defense is really your salvation, and then you'll try to become expert at this defense. But it's a heck of a lot easier to take refuge in right practice by saying, stones, released in the now. Dirt, released in the now. Water, released in the now. Footsteps, released in the now. Body, released in the now. Affliction, released in the now. Wind, released in the now. Universe, released in the now. Space, released in the now. Stars, released in the now. Galaxies, released in the now. Planets, released in the now. Tides, released in the now. Moons, released in the now. Electromagnetism, released in the now. Defensiveness, released in the now. Goddess, released in the now. Machinery, released in the now. Weapons, released in the now. Fear, released in the now. Shrubbery, released in the now. Flowers, released in the now. Pebbles, released in the now. Stickers, released in the now. Buildings, released in the now. Statues, released in the now. Birds, released in the now. Insects, released in the now. Creatures, released in the now. Leaf, released in the now. Antennas, released in the now. Televisions, released in the now. Satellites, released in the now. High energy particles, released in the now. Plasma, released in the now. Lasers, released in the now. LEDs, released in the now. Electronics, released in the now. Swimming pools, released in the now. Famine, released in the now. Droughts, released in the now. Flooding, released in the now. Boats, released in the now. Fish, released in the now. sharks released in the now, seashells released in the now, sand released in the now, salt released in the now, minerals released in the now, food released in the now. Floor released in the now. Brick released in the now. Adobe released in the now. Mud released in the now. Weeds released in the now. Weeds released in the now. Drugs released in the now. Music released in the now. Senses released in the now. Feelings released in the now. Sensations released in the now. Affection released in the now. Passion released in the now. Drama released in the now. Movies released in the now. Sports released in the now. Waiting released in the now. Hoping released in the now. Defensiveness released in the now. Simulation released in the now. Imagination released in the now. Universities released in the now. Books released in the now. Computers released in the now. Land released in the now. Cities released in the now. Countries released in the now. Continents released in the now. Underground released in the now. Practice released in the now. Effort released in the now. Light released in the now. Palm trees released in the now. Desert released in the now. Ice released in the now. Rain released in the now. Clouds released in the now. Weather released in the now. News released in the now. Antics released in the now. Money released in the now. Debt released in the now. Credit released in the now. Shopping released in the now. Textiles released in the now. Clothing released in the now. Shade released in the now. Shadows released in the now. Winning released in the now. Losing released in the now. Fatigue released in the now. Sleep released in the now. Sleeplessness released in the now. Dreaming released in the now. Confidence released in the now. Uncertainty released in the now. Roots released in the now. Garbage released in the now. Rubble released in the now. Sewage released in the now. Pastries released in the now. chocolates released in the now. Mosquitoes released in the now. Flies released in the now. Cats released in the now. Dogs released in the now. Training released in the now. Learning released in the now. Education released in the now. Thoughts released in the now. Concepts released in the now. Plans released in the now. Strategy released in the now. Symbols released in the now. Distraction released in the now. Decay released in the now. Death released in the now. Aging released in the now. Medicines released in the now. Surgeries released in the now. Hospitalization released in the now. Troubles released in the now. Successes released in the now. Status released in the now. Memories released in the now. Perfect days released in the now. Terrible days released in the now. Triumphs released in the now. Catastrophes released in the now. Hurricanes released in the now. Tornadoes released in the now. Freezes released in the now. Earthquakes released in the now. Tsunamis released in the now. Biohazards released in the now. Radiation released in the now. Plagues released in the now. Confusion released in the now. You see how easy it is to do this. And you just do it a little bit, and it has a tremendously beneficial effect for you. For everyone. Crowds released in the now. Society released in the now. Civilization released in the now. History released in the now. Evolution released in the now. Creation released in the now. Time-space process form released in the now. Simulation released in the now. Kingdoms released in the now. Migrations released in the now. Business released in the now. Bills released in the now. So don't wait for some guru or master bureaucracy or some law to free you from this universe or the troubles. You're the one who's sovereign over it. You have to release it. Nobody can release it for you. If you choose to bind yourself to this dream simulation for the preparation of time, you will be bound to it. If you choose to change the purpose and instead experience a universe that prepares you for time to never start, then you will experience that. celebrities released in the now, stars released in the now, actresses and actors released in the now, bureaucracy released in the now, heads of state released in the now, agencies released in the now, departments released in the now. Very interesting thing just happened, is the hacking of all the information of classified people at security clearances in the government of the United States. Everyone has a security clearance, has had their information, personal information, hacked by presumably a very unfriendly source, which they are suspecting China of. But of course, you have to understand the Chinese have specifically said the next World War III is going to be a cyber war. And who's to say that the World War III hasn't been raging for quite some time, which I've said it has been. I think it was, March of 2014 or something like that. Was it May or March? I think it was March. I said that World War III has started. It's a cyber war. And we're getting clobbered. U.S. is getting clobbered by this. I know that people listen to this all over the world. You might say that we're all getting clobbered by this. And this is a great example. There's been actually two breaches. Government employees, and then this latest one, people with security clearances. This is way more severe than they led us on to believe. Now, when you do this, you are basically blackmailing and pressuring to make a deal to go into this one world bureaucracy, actually. It severely subverts the sovereignty of any state, right, or nation. They want to consolidate all agencies and bureaucracies into a global bureaucracy with the purpose of making sure everybody on the planet gets on the same page, because they feel that's the only way we can function in the kingdom of time, even though this is not the kingdom of time. See, that's a little fact that we keep overlooking. This is not the kingdom of time we're living in. It's a dream simulation that our mind is projecting upon symbols. Projecting symbols, then projecting the play upon those symbols. We're not bound by anything here at all. This is not the kingdom of time at all. And so this whole simulation is voluntary. It's completely voluntary. But they want to make it seem like it's involuntary, that you have to play along. Otherwise suffer drastic consequences, annihilation. So, as I've said, about a year from now, today is the 13th of June, so in about a year from now, we need to have taken refuge in right practice. And if we have not, the pressures at that point will be, I believe, too severe. So don't wait. I don't know how much more I can do. Start practicing. You've basically got a gun to your head. The world's holding a gun to your head for sure. And so you say, hey, no, I'm not going to go along with this. I'm going to start practicing. And you'll choose between that and taking refuge in some of the goddess defense, basically, is what there are those who have tried to pull me into that. Saying, hey, this is the way to go. And I said, no, I think I can do these practices, actually. I'll take refuge in practice. And that is the right move for sure. For sure, don't doubt it. That is the right move. Taking refuge in right practice is the right move. Don't try to combine them. So, yeah, I can do that, but I'll also take refuge in the goddess. Let me cover both my bases. No, because you will find that your practicing gets pulled away from right practicing, and you end up trying to worship the goddess and hope that she can intercede with you so you don't have to practice. So it undermines your motivation very severely to try to do it that way. Some will say, well, yeah, I'm practicing a lot, but also I'm doing a lot of the goddess stuff, and that's a very bad way to go. Disastrous. And they'd say, well, how can I do both? You know, can you help me out? I don't want to do both. No, I'm not advising you do both. I'm advising everyone to take refuge in right spiritual practice. Drop the goddess worshiping, hoping that she can, that defense, you know, is going to work, because that just gives you false hope. False hope, false hope. And the threat is still there, so you become more and more enslaved by it. You can never do enough for the goddess because it doesn't work. The defense doesn't work. Because the feeling of lies being threatened by truth is always there. Beautiful day. This is my favorite kind of day. Very hot, but with a little bit of, you know, a little gusty breeze now and then that just, you know, keeps, nice cool breeze, then a little more there, then the heat builds up and then some more breeze, you know. That's wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. The heat wants you to just sit still, and right, you don't want to move around too much, so perfect for practicing, isn't it? Take refuge in practice in the heat, and then the breeze cooling you off a little bit. Say, oh, that's nice. And getting older is actually a blessing. I found it to be a blessing. I think I may have subverted my health early on just so I could sit still. But it actually got subverted simply by the stress. And there's a stress of trying to help out in this world, and finding it so difficult to get through to anybody just caused so much stress. But the end result was I could just sit quietly. I just could just sit. I was too tired to do anything else. But listen, you can take refuge in practice if you're not feeling well. Say, I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Remember, this whole scenario here is a dream scenario, symbolic dream scenario. You're not really in it at all. It's not true. You're not a body at all. Just a symbol. Body's just a symbol. You're not a body. You're just pretending to be identified with the body as a way to prepare for kingdom of time. But you are not a body. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still completely free. This is all voluntary. You see, this is entirely voluntary what we're doing. Completely up to us whether we continue this ridiculous simulation or not. Meaningless simulation. We're completely free to do something other than this. Yeah. Not bound at all. We're not bound at all. No one is bound in the slightest bit. Not one bit. This is not the kingdom of time. So there's no victimization taking place whatsoever. It's all completely voluntary what's happening here. We may volunteer to play the role of the victim, okay, thinking that's, you know, very helpful in figuring out how to deal with time, but it's completely voluntary. Completely voluntary. Being born is completely voluntary, actually. Everybody volunteers to come into this, quote-unquote, come into this world, to enter into this dream, really, of this world. At this level, enter into this dream. Everyone volunteers to do it. That doesn't, just because you volunteer doesn't mean you can't decide to resign from it. You can resign anytime you want to. It's completely optional for you. Completely optional. So any agreement you make is, again, just an optional agreement. See, I agree to be bound for at least a lifetime here. But you cannot bind yourself. So it's entirely up to you. You're not breaking any agreement. You cannot make an agreement with your freedom. Freedom, you can't make any deals with it, actually. So if we want to pretend that we're bound, we can pretend, but we're not bound to this pretense. There's no authority whatsoever that binds us to this pretense. God doesn't bind us to any agreement we make whatsoever. And since we're the creation of God, we are not bound either. We have no authority to bind ourselves to any agreement whatsoever. No authority. Just all voluntary. You can say, well, I chose to make a non-binding agreement, and now I'm choosing to different. I'm going to choose a different that I'm not going to be bound at all. Or I'll be bound, I choose to be bound by the dream of preparing for time to never start. All agreements are non-binding agreements. All agreements are non-binding agreements. And we say, like, whoa, the kingdom of time can't be that way. Of course, well, there is no kingdom of time. So this is all we have, is this non-binding situation, this non-binding simulation. That's it. That's all that arrogance could ever do, is have a completely non-binding simulation, dream simulation. That's all arrogance can ever do. I'm looking at this tree, which is dying. It's only putting off a few leaves this year. Last year it had leaves all over, but this year only a few. And you know the tree is dying. And next year probably will be dead. You can look at the world that way. You know there's so few leaves, so few people taking refuge in right spiritual practice, effective spiritual practice, so few around the world. You know the situation is quote-unquote dying. It is collapsing. Spiritual will is collapsing. It is going into this, you know, new world order of trying to finalize our preparations for time to start. That's it. And then we say, well, if time doesn't start, then we'll get back to this spiritual step. But we think that we have a way to start time, and it's going to start. There's some computer somewhere that we're going to, you know, boot it. It's going to get booted up, and off it goes. So you can tell, you know, how it's going by just how gung-ho are people on right spiritual practice right now around the world. People are so apathetic in the Catholic Church. It's just an astonishing. The priest will harangue you, but, you know, constantly saying, you know, just 5 minutes. Will you give me just 5 minutes a day? How many did 5 minutes a day the next time? Nobody raises their hand. Do you remember what your homework was? Nobody. No. Did you do it? Nobody. No. They'll sit there and listen and be harangued, but they won't do it. They won't do it. It's incredible lack of compliance with... the priests are giving good advice, actually. They're trying to get you to spend... You know, they're warning us, actually. The priests are warning. If you listen to what they're saying in the Catholic Church, they're warning us, the priests, which are still being run by bishops to some extent, but the Pope is desperately trying to change that by pulling out the old card of a victimization card and saying we have to exercise now very strict discipline. They have a Vatican Council now overseeing all bishops. If any bishop, you know, shelters a priest from that's engaged in wrong, quote-unquote, wrongdoing, then they're subject to immediate sanctions, etc. So they want to, what they have to do is make sure that no bishops run things the way that they think is best to run it. The oversight is now at the level of the highest bureaucracy. So they created a new layer of bureaucracy in the Vatican to police all the bishops. This is an extraordinary development in the world, because this has not been the way that the whole church was ever set up. The authority was always invested in the bishops. Okay, and there was a balance of authority, just like in the United States Constitution, a balance of authority between the legislative and executive and judicial branches, where now the executive is trying to gain all authority over both legislative and judicial branches. Same thing with the papacy. It is the Vatican is trying to gain control over the authority of the bishops right now, and they're, you know, using this playing this card of the priests molesting children to attain it as a reason to do this. This completely upsets the apple cart of bishops having being way more in touch with their bishopric of the area where the diocese, knowing how people, you know, what's going on there, what are the people like, how can we push them, how can we help them, what, you know, they're very in touch with it, very in touch with it. And the church was set up as these dioceses of bishops. And the coordination among that was just, the Vatican was a way of helping coordinate the situation and facilitate it. And they'd elect certain bishops as pope, the cardinals, pope, you know. You don't get to be a cardinal unless you're a bishop before then, and you don't get to be a pope unless you're a cardinal usually before that, you see. So in other words, these bishops understand the way things have to go, but now we have this pope, which I already excommunicated for good reason. In my universe, the pope's excommunicated. And so here he goes, setting up this super important, super powerful new layer of bureaucracy, which is going to put the bishops under the hammer, like police state. They're going to be policing all the bishops. Now, it's a very delicate issue, actually, the whole thing, because the church teaches forgiveness, second chances, and all that. And to develop a zero-tolerance policy is an extraordinary interference in the catechism of the church, the purpose of the church. The church says we're all sinners, we all make faults. What it's really saying is we're all engaged in this dance of simulating what Kingdom of Time is going to be like. And to do that, we have victims and victimizers. They're actually acting out these roles to try and, you know, figure out how to defend against God. So what the church teaches is forgiveness. All parties in disputes, forgive one another and let it go and pray for the grace of God to enlighten you about eternal life. And that's what its purpose is. So it's a very delicate situation, which, and basically the Pope just, you know, brought a hammer down on it all. And tends to bring a sledgehammer down on a lot of stuff very strongly. But I think it's an overreach, severe overreach on the part of the Pope, severe overreach. Just like this trade agreement was a severe overreach on the part of the POTUS. Of course, the Pope can get his way without, a lot easier. And I think the president would love to be pope, you know, love to have that authority where he didn't have to worry about the legislature, just sledgehammer everything through and just say, this is what I want, this is what I get. So, you know, you have to realize that this stuff is happening. Huge, major shifts are happening every day in this world now. You won't even recognize the landscape in a year from now, actually. In fact, the landscape we're in right now is almost unrecognizable from a year ago. So much has changed. And again, take refuge in right practice. Yeah, so I just pray to Jesus that I help everyone out more. You know, what can I do to help people out? They have to start actually doing this instead of just thinking about it. I didn't say take refuge in thinking about doing it. Take refuge in doing it. And you will find that you're able to withstand these massive shifts. And you won't take refuge in one of these very clever defenses against God, which only exacerbates the belief that you're vulnerable. How are we doing on the video here? We're doing very well. Problem is these shifts will be so severe, people will be frantically trying to figure out, how do I adapt? Taking refuge in adaptability, but that's not the way. Take refuge in right spiritual practice. That centers you like that. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Oh, guess what? my participation in this simulation for the kingdom of time is completely voluntary. I'm absolutely free to change the purpose of this simulation. Right this minute, I'm free, actually. See how empowering that is? What you need is real empowerment. What we, everyone, needs is real empowerment. And right spiritual practice leads to real empowerment. And real empowerment is changing the purpose of this dream simulation. You do it for yourself. Now, others will be blind. They'll look at things and say, I don't see anything different. You'll see the light playing with everything, and you experience this beautiful simulation preparing you to realize that time will never start. You'll be experiencing the absolute grace of this, and they'll still be blind to it because that's not their purpose for their imagination. So they'll see the tree. Oh, it's just a tree. What are you talking about? And you'll see this dance of freedom. This dance of grace and freedom. You'll see this continual released in the nowness, released in the nowness, released in the nowness. This oneness, that's what you'll see, but they won't see it at all. So that's the answer. How can we all have these, each have our own unique universe in terms of our perception, but when we change the purpose, then we will get this new purpose and be experiencing the freedom. The freedom, the freedom, the freedom. From concept, from definition, from label, from symbol, from words. And we will be experiencing this preparation. What we're doing, so we're experiencing preparation to realize that time will never start. That's what we'll be experiencing. It's a preparation. So we'll be just enjoying that preparation. Whereas others will be, not experiencing that at all. And be in, big, have a real big headache, a real misery. Not enough Advil for that headache, that's for sure. All the while, though, a lot of people thinking, we're just about there. We're just about there. Time is ready to start. I think I'm just about ready. I just need to make sure that everybody treats me like I'm infallible. And then I'll be ready. I just want to make sure that everyone's going to do exactly what I tell them to do without any backlash whatsoever. And then I'll be ready. So we're almost there. So a group of people are so desperate to prepare for time that they're frantically grabbing hold of all the power in this world, frantically. So they can say, yeah, I'm ready, time, you can start now, because I can force everybody to do exactly what I want them to do, and they don't dare express any displeasure. In fact, they're going to praise me for telling them to do this, do this, do this, do this. Almost ready. So we have these band of desperados in the world right now who are seizing all the positions of power and authority. And all the bureaucratic positions of power, authority, agencies, et cetera, media, whatever. They're seizing these. They're barging in. They're grabbing hold of them. They're demanding them, This is where I got to be. Get out of here. I need this. I need this. I need this. And, of course, the rest of us who are preparing to change the purpose of this dream, we're not even thinking about that at all. We're only thinking about taking refuge in right spiritual practice. We're not trying to gain some authority in the world at all right now. That's not where it's at all. We are sovereign over our own dream. We're sovereign over it. We can change the purpose of it. So either time's going to start or it isn't. So either you're preparing for the start of time or you're preparing for time to never start. Those are the only two simulations you can have, actually. You can't really have a simulation of it's both starting and not starting. You cannot. That leads to mental chaos. So you're either preparing for time to start or you're preparing for time to not start. Those are the options we have. And trying to confuse and blur the options prevents us from choosing wisely, doesn't it? Because if we're confused, we're going to stick with status quo almost always. So the ego loves to confuse the issue for us. And so we're not sure, I'm not sure, maybe we can have both. You have both. not realizing that's impossible. You know, and so we realize that's impossible. Then we see very clearly we have two options. We have to choose among those options. We've already chosen to try and prepare for time, and now we can choose to prepare for time never starting. Even the crow's voice sounds pretty weak right now. It's like, I'm hot. That was a weak, very weak crow voice there. Like saying, yeah, birds get hot too. He's like, there's heat. Having black feathers probably doesn't help. So don't have black feathers during this time coming up, not time, but during this phase of preparation for time to start. Don't have black feathers at that time. It's going to get too hot for you. Put on the white feathers of right spiritual practice. Repels, reflects the heat, you know, reflects the pressure. Be not pulled down into darkness thinking that that's the light of salvation. It's not. But again, we're pursuing success, a successful preparation. So we think that by pulling down in this darkness, we'll ultimately, this is going to enable us to properly prepare for time, the kingdom of time. And of course, it doesn't, because there is no kingdom of time. All it does is make us miserable, make us feel very miserable, very frightened, very threatened, very vulnerable, very agitated, very sensitive, victim consciousness, all this stuff. This is where, of course, the world is getting dragged down into by the zealots who have seized power all over the world. Now, people still act like they have common sense, but the clarity of the options, they don't have that. If you don't have clarity of options, you're sunk. Because you're gonna be dragged along, you be keel hauled, pulled down into this black hole, because you don't know what else to choose. So, this is the thing: is most people think, well, I'm still have common sense. I still I'm able to think for myself and common sense and everything, but they have not clarified what the options really are. And so, when push comes to shove, they're going to stay with what they're used to. What they're familiar with, which is preparing for kingdom of time. Absolutely, that's what they'll do. So don't be fooled by the fact that people are still seeming to be pretty much okay. Yeah, I still got common sense. And no, they've lost sight of their option, the options, what the choice is. They've lost sight of what the choice is. They don't know. This is what I found out. All these good-meaning, well-meaning people, they think they're functioning fine, and you push them a little bit, you find out they don't have a clue as what. That they have a choice, what their options are. They just figure, well, I'll be able to somehow soldier on, somehow, But they don't realize they have an option. Just don't realize it. So, when push comes to shove, as it soon will, that's when they'll find out, I guess I didn't prepare very well. What's going on? Or, it looks like I didn't do my spiritual work. I thought I could get by watching TV. That didn't work out so well. So, here we go. We're headed towards the... No, we're not. What? Actually, for some reason, this video has not used as much memory. Is that possible? It looks like it. Let me see. Let me just look up here. Yeah. Wow. I can't explain that. So we still have like half a gigabyte left, which is how much time? 4 gigabytes is 2.5 hours. Half a gigabyte is then a little bit less, maybe 25 minutes or so. can't explain this. Maybe it's a miracle. It's giving us more time together here. Not time, more, giving us more opportunity here together. Right? Giving us more opportunity. Now let's see if it's shut. I think it'll keep going, actually. It's not the time, it's the gigabytes. Now keep in mind that practicing is you're not going out walking around nature. You can do it that way, but it's oftentimes you're in your little meditation space, you're in your own practice place, a little nook, your little retreat. And if you're in some area like Hawaii where you think, oh, let's go out and go to the beach and stuff, you're not going to be practicing so much. I've often heard that the best practice occurs in places that you just don't even feel like going out. You know, it's kind of cold, foggy, whatever, and you say, ah, what the heck, I'd rather just sit here in the room and study for the next 5 hours. Or if you're not feeling so good like me, tired, say, what, I can't really enjoy a hike, I can't even go on a hike, I'm not too out of shape, so what do? Just sit here and practice, and you know, take refuge in practice. So don't be fooled by the goddess. She'll peddle Hawaii to you. It's one of her favorite ones. Tropical island retreat, this and this. Get out there in nature, enjoy nature. It's so nice. And what do? When you go that way, you stop practicing. Cuts way into your practice. You think, no, I'm going to practice when I get home. Like golf. Why don't you go golf? People say, why don't you go golf? I said, I don't know. I said, I might. Now, you know, you can tape when you get home. Well, when I get home, I'm tired, I'm achy, I got to eat. Before you know it, you know, I'm no inspiration, can't tape. Whoops. That's all I say, before, you know, practicing before food, before anything else, pleasure, recreation. Even, I often do it before I even eat in the morning. You just do it before you eat. You know, take care of that first. Take care of right spirit, taking refuge in right practice first. Take care of that first. And then if you want to do other stuff, there's time. Well, you know, maybe, maybe not. Leave that open, maybe. Oh, the goddess that promised me so much. Well, you know, living in mansions in Hawaii, you know, and all the recreation of golfing in Hawaii for the rest of my life. You know, snorkeling and just living this beautiful beach Hawaii life. And, well, you know, just wonderful colors, Hawaiian shirts and fashions, and just, you know, the perfect atmosphere. Oh, you're just going to love it there. I was just promised that nonstop. I mean, just, she marketed it like a maniac to me. Tropical island retreats. You know, you're going to live the greatest life. You know, just taking it easy and just enjoying yourself. Play golf every day. This was an obsession that the goddess was marketing this to me. Because it worked, you know. I said, like, wow, that sounds pretty nice. But how do I help people? So, oh, you'll have plenty of time for that too. Don't worry. You can do it all, can't you? You know, that's her, one of her tricks. Says, why? What's the matter? Your spirit, right? You can do it all. You can make both truth and lies true. You're so great. What do you mean you can't do it all? You know, said, well, if that's the case, then let me at least do what's essential first, okay, and then we'll see if I'm able to do it all at that point. Well, let me make sure I take care of business first here and take refuge in right spiritual practice before I take refuge in some place like Hawaii. You know, what kind of refuge do you have in Hawaii if you don't have refuge in right spiritual practice? You don't have any refuge there. I've talked to people living like the nicest places possible there. Do they really have refuge? No. No. Yeah, it's continuing on, isn't it? This is awesome. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. I don't know how to explain it. Put it down as a miracle. Helping us transition into the new purpose of this dream simulation, that of helping us prepare to realize that time is never going to start. There's never going to be any kingdom of time, ever. Help us to realize this. Yeah, if you're in Hawaii, I'd be picking like leaves and flowers and making flower arrangements. I like doing that, just setting up all these vases everywhere, flowers everywhere, beautifying the house, the yard, making flower leys, and I've done all that kind of stuff, and I like it because it's beautiful, it's fragrant, it's beautiful. And so instead of practicing, I'd be doing all this other stuff for sure. Holding celebrations where people come and eat and drink and laugh and play. I'd be playing music, I'd be singing, I'd be playing the ukulele and guitar. I'd be really into that. I'd be very good at it, and singing with these groups and wearing super colorful Hawaiian clothes and hats. And we'd all be posing like we're beautiful people in a beautiful place and acting like we're so spiritually advanced. And throwing another lay on and saying, "Ah, look at this! I'm nature, Mother Nature's son here. Are you kidding me? Mother Nature's son, this is awesome." Taking hikes to waterfalls and helicopter rides and hiking and just leading the good Hawaiian life. Fruit, eating fruit every day, papayas, etc. And then, of course, playing all great golf courses over there. It just, play 36 holes a day. It was great. I was promised everything like that. Promised. I said, "Well, how am I going to pay for all this?" He says, "Oh, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. Just keep doing what I tell you to do, and that'll all take care of itself. Don't worry." Well, it didn't take care of itself, actually. It was all a lie, all a deception, all a mirage, all false promises. What the goddess does, wants you to pay for everything, and then she wants to take credit. She says, "Look, see, I got you here. Yeah, but I killed myself working." So, no, I gave you that work. And says, she takes whatever good, she takes credit for it. Whatever bad, it's your fault. That's how it works. That's how it works. If it didn't work out fine, well, you didn't do what I told you to do. If you'd done what I told you to do, everything worked out perfect for you. I say, "Well," I said, no, thanks, guys. I'll do what Jesus tells me to do. You know what Jesus tells me to do? Practice right now. That's what he tells me to do. I'm not even paying for this practice. This is free for me. I'm just doing it for free. I don't have to, pay a fee to practice." So be very careful you don't get pulled into that. It is a diabolical defensive scheme. You end up dressing in more and more fashionable clothes, more and more colorful clothes, trying to present just how happy and successful and fulfilled you are, and to inspire others to follow the goddess too. You become a missionary for the goddess, actually. Trying to say, "Look at me, I'm living in Hawaii. Look at these beautiful pictures. Look at these beautiful clothes. Wow, you could do this too. All you got to do is follow the goddess, and she'll put you there too." These are missionaries. These are missionaries that she's using to pull you into this defensive posture, which we feel will be necessary. We have to. Everyone has to be absolutely convinced that the goddess can intercede with God and charm God. Otherwise, we're going to be annihilated. This is the notion that we work under, a false notion. Still a lot of time left. This is amazing. Bonus coverage today, bonus coverage. I guess this video is so great that the Holy Spirit says, keep on going. This is great. What else do I have to do today anyway? Saturday. No, I'm not throwing frisbee in Golden Gate Park, okay? Playing guitar on Hippie Hill, which I've done, all that stuff. Bring your guitar to Hippie Hill, hang out, maybe some some beautiful people will come on over and say, hey, wow, yeah, just want to hang out here for a while, hippie hill. Not wearing tie-dye clothes, and got a dog, tossing the frisbee, going to the beach, strolling on the beach, you know, all this stuff. Just sitting here, taking refuge in right practice. And of course, not having money is a great help. Can't do anything, can't take a vacation. Now, even on vacations, I can keep practicing. Still a distraction, isn't it? I don't think the level of practicing is as high as this. But yeah, right now, actually, not having money and not having very good health is an extreme benefit. Extreme benefit. So if you have both of those, you're very, very blessed. Just keep taking refuge in right spiritual practice. I think the worst thing that right now to do would be to have a lot of money. That would be terrible. And again, being real physically fit, you tend to want to go do stuff, take a bike ride. And people here are just maniacs for physical fitness, so they're going to yoga, you know, constantly, and riding their bikes, and kayaking, and just, you know, just soccer. I mean, they're just go. Got to be physical fit, playing golf, baseball, basketball, whatever you can think of. They're roller skating, skateboarding, running, jogging, gym, at the gym. And me, I can't do any of that, so I'm just sitting here. Can't afford any of that anyway. So, double blessing. A little bit feeble, very much poor, equals a very great blessing. Jesus said, blessed are the poor, right? He said something about that. It's interesting. It's true, because what else can you do? Just sit here and take refuge. Don't spend any money, don't go anywhere, just practice. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. So if you're housebound, you know, you're very blessed. If you're just super meager, you know, means, very blessed. Like, for instance, you know, I don't even dare go anywhere, store anything, because I can't buy anything. So what's the point of going shopping? You know, it's better to stay away, because otherwise you'll be tempted and a lot of conflict will arise. Oh, I want that. Oh, I want that. Oh, it'd be nice if I had that. Then that never ends. That's what stores are for, is make you think like, wow, my life would be a little happier if I had that. You know, oh, that'd be nice. You can always find, you know, 100 things if you go shopping that you think, wow, this will really help improve my life. So I don't even go to stores. Don't even go out. Don't even go to stores at all. Keep it simple. What do I always say? All you need is a microwave and a Foreman grill and a Nutribullet. Those three items, and you can handle just about anything. Shopping's done for as far as the kitchen goes. And that, just eat and practice. So that's it. So the ones who seem to be tied down and are not the movers and shakers, the poor people who are in their little apartment or somewhere, barely getting by with get up in the morning, I got no job, what the heck do I do? Oh, let me practice for the entire day here. let me spend 8 hours in intense practice. Those are the ones that are blessed. It's even a blessing because I don't have much work right now. In fact, the next 2 weeks are a big problem for me. What can I do? Practice more intensely. That's what I can do. Just keep in mind that about a year from now, the you know what is going to hit the fan. And all bets are off at that point. So you'd better, it's better that you are able to take refuge in right practice than if you have $10 billion. You're way better off. I mean, you know, I wouldn't trade places with anybody. I wouldn't trade places with Warren Buffett or Bill Gates or, you know, all these rich people. No way. No way would I trade places with them. They'd give their whole fortune to trade places with me, but it's not for sale. It's not for sale. It's not something you can sell. You know, this capacity to take refuge in right practice is nothing you can sell as a commodity. It's not sellable as a commodity at all. So their money is worthless to them in that regard. It's totally worthless. You just tell them, you know, just sit in your room and practice. No, wait a minute, I got all this money, I got to make it work, I got to do stuff with it, you know. No, just don't worry about your money, just sit. Like Jesus said to the rich person, the prince, just give all your money away, everything away, follow me. He said, no, I can't do that, I got, you know, no. Hey, you know, Mr. Moneybags, you know, forget about your money, just sit in your room and practice. What? What are you talking about? What good is my money then? Well, it's really not much good to you at all, as a matter of fact. I gotta be online. So I gotta order, you know, $50,000 bottle of wine, and I gotta go down to the wine. I gotta get, you know, I've gotta work with my wine sommelier, and have to, you know, or get the chef to, you know, prepare the right meal. There's a lot of stuff I gotta do to make my life, you know, livable here. No, just sit in your room, just practice, study, practice, practice, study, study, practice, practice, study. That's the way to success. I can't move around very good. I can't play golf anymore. My shoulders hurt. My hips hurt. And said, well, great. I'll just sit quietly and practice. No, I got to get surgery. I got to do rehab. And then, you know, that's going to take a lot of time. I can't have time for that. No, just let the hip be sore or whatever it is and just practice right now. This is my advice to everybody. Just whatever, do whatever you can do to just practice right now. Tomorrow may be too late. You know, tomorrow... the intensity demand for conformity may be too strong. The attraction to feeling you need, that everyone's going to say, hey, if everyone in the world woke up today and started screaming, running around, telling everyone, hey, we know for sure the time is going to start in a couple of days, you know, or next year or whatever, would you be able to just brush them aside and say, leave me alone, I'm practicing, and not be troubled by it at all? Because this is what basically we're going to get in this world. We're already getting it. The attitude of people is that they believe time is just about ready to start, and they're convinced of it. So it's extremely difficult to maintain your practicing right now. I think a lot of us are having trouble. Keep in mind that this effort they're rushing towards to get rid of what they call darkness, is really what they feel is the threat of an invasion by God, and they think they've almost got the defenses necessary to prevent that, and then they think once they figure out how to prevent that, then time can start and we'll feel safe in it. You know, they said we don't want to start time yet because we don't feel quite safe. That's our arrogance. Because arrogance says, oh yeah, we can start time anytime if we want to. I mean, or we can start right now, but we're not quite ready for it. You see, we got to make sure that God cannot snatch it away from us. so they're rushing towards this effort to defeat the darkness, thinking they have the light necessary to defeat the darkness. The light of what? Defensiveness. They look at defensiveness as light, and they look at God as darkness. As a threat. And they think they can finally defeat this threat. So it's quite difficult to just abide in this. But we can do it. I'm still not there, but you know, keep trying. It's getting better and better and better. Closer and closer. It's pretty difficult to resist. They say, "Hey, we've finally found a way to get, you know, to get rid of this threat that we're feeling." And you think, "Oh, that's great. You know, I'm so tired of feeling threatened. You know, that's great. You found a way." But they haven't found a way at all. They think that producing the right defenses will intimidate God and defeat God. Whereas what I'm saying is, liberate your universe, your dream universe, from the demand that you put on it to be a simulation of a period of time, and change the purpose and say, now you're a simulation, dream simulation of a pair me, to realize that time will never start. That is, there's no threat to that at all. There's no threat there at all. So that is the answer. Not developing some successful defense against the threat of God. That is not the answer. It's never the answer. There's no time at all, and there's no defenses against the inner feeling we feel about our idea of time being threatened. Arrogance always feels threatened by reality. So we just play with this, thinking we made it less, we lessened the threat. Okay, well, we made significant progress, and from there, we'll be able to build upon that. And then, whoops, the threat tends to get bigger. Oh, let's put it back again. It goes on and on and on this way.